Urinary incontinence is a problem where the process of urination, also called micturition, happens involuntarily, meaning that a person might urinate without intending to. Urinary incontinence is especially problematic because it affects a person's personal hygiene as well as their social life in a way that can be very limiting. Normally, urine's held in the bladder, which receives urine from two ureters coming down from the kidneys, and then that urine leaves the bladder through the urethra. As urine flows from the kidney through the ureters and into the bladder starts to expand into the abdomen. The bladder is able to expand and contract because it's wrapped in a muscular layer, called the detrusor muscle, and within that, lining the bladder itself, is a layer of transitional epithelium, containing umbrella cells. These umbrella cells get their name because they physically stretch out as the bladder fills, just like an umbrella opening in slow motion. In a grown adult, the bladder can expand to hold about 750 milliliters, slightly less in women than in men, because the uterus takes up space, which crowds out the bladder a little bit. Alright, so when the urine's collecting in the bladder, there are basically two doors that are shut, which holds the urine in. The first door is the internal sphincter muscle, which is made of smooth muscle and is under involuntary control, meaning that it opens and closes automatically. Typically, that internal sphincter muscle opens up when the bladder is about half full. The second door is the external sphincter muscle, and it's made of skeletal muscles and is under voluntary control, meaning that it opens and closes when a person wants it to. This is the reason that it's possible to stop urine midstream by tightening up that muscle, which is called doing Kegel exercises. Once urine has passed through the external sphincter muscle, it exits the body. In women, the exit's immediate, and in men, the urine flows through the penis before it exits. So when specialized nerves called stretch receptors in the bladder wall sense that the bladder is about half full, they send impulses to the spinal cord, specifically the sacral spinal cord at levels S2 and S3, known as the micturition center, and the brain, specifically two locations in the pons, the pontine storage center and the pontine micturition center. The spinal cord response is part of the micturition reflex, and it causes an increase in parasympathetic stimulation and decrease in sympathetic stimulation, which makes the detrusor muscle contract and the internal sphincter relax. It also decreases motor nerve stimulation to the external sphincter, allowing it to relax as well. At this point, urination would happen, if not for the pons. The pons is the region of the brain that we train to voluntarily control urination. If we want to delay urination, or hold it in, the pontine storage center overrides the micturition reflex. And when we want to urinate, the pontine micturition center allows for the micturition reflex to happen. Now, there are a few types of urinary incontinence. The first is urge incontinence, which is when someone has a sudden urge to urinate because of an overactive bladder, followed immediately by involuntary urination. This is typically due to an uninhibited detrusor muscle that contracts randomly. This usually results in frequent urination, especially at night. To treat urge incontinence, the focus is on decreasing the detrusor muscle activity. Relaxation techniques to relax the bladder as well as anti-muscarinic medications can decrease detrusor muscle contractions. Next, there's stress incontinence, which is usually due to increased abdominal pressure that overwhelms the sphincter muscles and allows urine to leak out. Think of things that cause exertion, like sneezing, coughing, and laughing. Anything that puts pressure on the bladder. This is also relevant during pregnancy, when a growing baby puts tremendous pressure on the bladder and causes stress incontinence in some women. The classic finding is urinary leakage with pressure applied to the abdomen. Stress incontinence treatments typically focus on strengthening the external sphincter muscle by doing things like Kegel exercises. Another type is overflow incontinence, which is typically caused by some sort of problem with emptying the bladder. This could be due to a blockage in urine flow, like a hypertrophic prostate in men, which presses on the urethra, or an ineffective detrusor muscle. Either way, the bladder doesn't empty properly, and as a result, the bladder fills up and overflows with urine, which leaks through the sphincters. Typically, this results in a weak or intermittent urinary stream or hesitancy, where it takes a while for the urine to start to flow because of the blockage in the path. Overflow treatments are aimed at reestablishing a clear pathway for urine flow. For example, that might be through catheterization or medications like alpha blockers, which can limit prostate enlargement. Finally, there are various conditions like diabetes, bladder cancer, Parkinson's, and multiple sclerosis, as well as procedures like prostatectomy or hysterectomy, that can damage the nerves involved in the micturition reflex, ultimately leading to urinary incontinence. The symptoms and treatment for these problems depend on the exact condition. Alright, as a quick recap, urinary incontinence happens when urine involuntarily leaves the bladder, through the internal and external sphincter muscles. Urge incontinence is due to an overactive bladder, stress incontinence is due to too much pressure for the sphincter muscles to resist, and overflow incontinence is due to incomplete emptying of the bladder. Hey guys, thanks for watching. Hope you liked that one. Special thanks goes to Vanita Gaglani for both helping to edit the script on that one as well as sponsor the video. Vanita's got her own website called Vanita's Rehab, and she's a registered physical therapist who has actually written a book on urinary incontinence. So it's really awesome to have her help with that video. Other than that, you can check out our new subreddit called rosmosit. We're going to be posting videos to there and having discussions as well. And then you can also obviously subscribe to our channel, like our videos, or donate to us on Patreon. Thanks, guys. Bye.